Back in 2015, LoRaWAN technology, with the publication of the very first standard and the formation of the LoRa Alliance, has started its life. Ever since then, it has been effectively building the digital nervous system of our planet and complementing the digital brain, the AI. In Actility, as a co-inventor of the LoRaWAN technology and a founding member of the LoRa Alliance, we have been one of the driving forces behind this development. In this new video series, together with the LoRaWAN ecosystem players, we would like to talk about the technology, its implementation and deployments. There's a lot happening in this exciting field, and we would like to use this opportunity to share some of them with you. My name is Alper Yegin. I'm the CTO of Actility and Vice Chair of the Board and Chair of the Technical Committee of the LoRa Alliance. I will be hosting our new video series called Building Massive IoT. Our first speaker is Olivier Hersent. He is the founder and CEO of Actility. Olivier is one of the authors of the very first LoRaWAN specification, along with the colleagues from IBM and Semtech. He has been instrumental in bringing this technology to life through the technical and the business innovation that he has been spearheading. Let's listen to Olivier capturing the device and network growth trends, new technical features, and evolving use of the existing ones, and accelerated adoption in certain verticals such as oil, gas, and mining.
Hi, everyone. This is Olivier Hersent. I'm managing Actility. We are doing a lot of deployments, public and private, all over the world. And I thought it was interesting, as we're entering 2024, to provide a highlight on the new trends, share with you a couple of our KPIs, how fast the network is growing, and also some of the innovations that I believe are going to facilitate our lives, deploying networks, decrease CapEx, and so on. Starting with network KPIs, we are tracking those for many years now. So take it as an index. It's not 100% of our customers. It's those that we can track accurately, but it's really representative of how fast the LoRaWAN world is growing. And this is the first chart representing the number of active devices. There are many, many more provisioned devices, but you never know when a device doesn't talk, if it's really still there or if it's been replaced. So we believe the KPIs on active devices, which have been actively communicating in the past months, are more reliable. You can see that on overall index size of 3 million devices, we had, again, about 50% growth rate in 2023. Every bar is a month, and the red is the month in 2022, the green is the corresponding months in 2023. So you see that the growth rate in terms of number of active devices is quite high, actually higher than what analysts are predicting. Usually you get a consensus around 35% year-over-year growth rate for LP1 devices. Regardless of technology, it's not really LoRaWAN versus any other LTE-M. Overall, the consensus for the category is 35%. And we don't really know if we are growing faster than the category or if LoRaWAN is growing faster than the category. But in any case, that's good news. The second KPI that we are tracking is the network size, which we measure in terms of number of active gateways. So, connected to the network, relaying traffic. And here, 2023 was big disappointment. The growth rate decreased from something incredibly high in 2022. This was as high as 70% year over year, certain months. And it went down to 23%. The analysis for that is very simple. Looking backwards, we understand that the 70% growth rate that we saw in 2022 was related to COVID. Many companies were afraid that they would not be able to source gateways, to buy new hardware, problems with delivery times, and so on. So they made a lot of precaution inventory. And during 2023, they found that they had overstock, and therefore they didn't buy as much. So that's how we explain this kind of KPI. When we look at our forecasts and backlog, actually, for 2024, we see a very strong bounce. So we believe that the growth rate in terms of number of gateways deployed will get back to normal in 2024. The past two KPIs, they are an aggregate of enterprise and public networks. So really it's a mix. It's interesting to zoom in on only enterprise. And if you do this, on this slide. That's the curve, you know, since we introduced our enterprise products, and you see that we had over 80% increase in number of gateways in actively deployed in 2023, and we see the same trend in 2024. So the message is that the enterprise segment is very, very dynamic, and that includes, of course, private networks deployed by an enterprise for themselves, but also managed networks, SaaS managed networks that are powered by a service provider. So these were the KPIs as we're entering 2024. So pretty bullish message on the acceleration of IoT. We're finally seeing the growth that we had been expecting for a few years. Now I want to share some news in terms of technology, the things that we believe are changing the game, worthy of noting. The first one is LoRaWAN relays. So these are really a game changer for utilities and smart buildings. Relays have been around for other technologies for a long time. You have relays for wireless Embus and similar metering technologies. The rationale is that deploying a network for the meters or the devices that are hardest to reach is increasingly expensive. The last few percent of devices that you need to reach might take as much as 20% of additional capex, and therefore additional opex if you need to pay for renting space, manage the antennas, and so on. So the solution had been found a long time ago by the companies that are used to deploying large quantities of meters in the form of relays. That was not existing in LoRa. It was not existing in a standard form. And this was fixed finally by the LoRa Alliance last year. We had the first interoperable relays and network servers demonstrated at the NLIT trade show towards the end of 2022. And this really allows to cover hard-to-reach meters without having to deploy mains-powered, infrastructured, rooftop gateways, these kind of things. It's also a very big help in the smart building space, not small buildings, sorry for the typo, in two types of segments. You might have enterprises that need to deploy temperature sensors, air quality sensors, in hundreds of offices, but these are very, very small offices. So in that case, a relay might be good enough to provide coverage, for example, to extend the reach of a public network. And there is also the case of very large buildings that are generally covered quite well with two or three gateways, but you might have this or that corner that have that are hard to reach, cabinets. And also in that type of use case, the relays are very useful. Relays are a bit tricky when it comes to battery life. It's actually quite complex calculation to estimate the impact, which is always positive on a device. It's usually using a lot less battery than without a relay. Or if it's using more battery, it's only because without a relay, it would have been disconnected. But if you want to estimate battery life, both for the relay and the devices, you need really to take everything into account. So we built a tool, and you can reach this tool through our relay documentation page. There is a link. I won't go through details here. You need to fill up the number of devices covered by a relay, the data rates that are being used, et cetera, et cetera. And then it provides a very accurate and detailed estimation of the power consumption, and also telling you where you're losing most power. We take into account battery leakage, idle power of the processors, all sorts of things like this. It's, I believe, a very useful tool when you are planning this new generation of deployments, leveraging relays to decrease CapEx and OPEX. We see a lot of interest in deployments. There are many regional deployments now that are looking at this technology. Something else that we expected but really came to the real world in 2023, I wanted to highlight this here, is the collaboration between public and private. As you know, LoRaWAN is very special in that since the very beginning, there has been a great deal of attention to making this technology collaborative. Unlike Wi-Fi, where you get a bunch of networks that really don't collaborate in any way, LoRaWAN, with the notion of network ID, the notion of roaming, has been built in a way that networks can collaborate. And it's solving a typical case that utilities have. The dilemma is that public networks, they don't cover all the meters. Of course, you know, they are done for all use cases on average on a given area, but they will not focus the coverage calculations on your specific use case. So there will always be a few meters that will be missing. Vice versa, if you want to deploy a private network for your use case, might be water metering, it might be smart lighting, it will tend to be a bit costly for just one use case. So the solution is obvious: combine public and private. The public networks you can patch very quickly by your own private gateways. And also for cost optimization, if you have very high density zones, you have thousands of sensors that can be covered by a single gateway, you can place a private gateway here to decrease the bill that you'll get from the public network. So this is happening now. The first that we are aware of to a large industrial scale is Bird's Veolia with their private network roaming with Orange. It's been extremely successful. It's provided really agility for Birds to sign a contract with the city and immediately be able to provide the SLAs that are required by the city in terms of meters that are covered, lack of gaps in the metering information. Also, a huge increase in quality of service perceived by the meters. And overall decrease also of the battery usage by the meters through the collaboration between the public and private network. So we think that success is the beginning of a long series. And actually, we also believe that roaming is going to become the norm for utilities to deploy their LoRaWAN core network. If you take Italgas in Italy, the core network of Italgas is a LoRaWAN home network. And the meters, they are roaming with the local access networks all over Italy. That allows Italgas to have collaboration of networks. They don't need to choose a given network. They don't need to deploy the network itself. Any network deployed in Italy which offers the roaming, the standard LoRaWAN roaming facility, can be used by Italgas. So really the same idea as what Birds has leveraged for Orange. Another thing I wanted to highlight is specific use case where we see a lot of success. And I thought I wanted to share this. It's the oil and gas and mining segments. These are environments that share the presence of explosive gases, explosive dust, and so on. So they require specific certifications called ATEX in Europe, ICX worldwide. And you have several zoning requirements, you know, from zone 2, which is relatively simple to achieve, all the way to zone 0, which is extremely difficult to achieve. These are always very large campuses, so the need for long-range communication is obvious. So obviously, LoRaWAN is a prime candidate. There is a very, very big focus on safety, particularly worker safety. So all the equipments that are related to safety and IoT in this particular segment, they do have budgets that are available to spend. And last but not least, the ATEX ICX certification requires extremely low energy. You need to be able to prove to the certification bodies that the energy in your device is low enough that it will not cause a spark. This is an extreme simplification of ICX. But you will understand that because LoRaWAN is low power, particularly is low current. You know, the peak current in LoRaWAN is about 30 milliamps, when it's about 10 times this for cellular devices. It really helps a lot in designing ATEX compliant equipment, particularly when it's portable and you care about the weight, because of course you could add a big metal cage to every sensor, but if you wear it, if you talk about worker safety, then weight is really important. So that segment is sort of a perfect match for LoRaWAN, and they've found each other and really were seeing a lot of traction in that segment in 2023, we had already, and of course expecting same success in 2024. I could mention many other things. This one is still a little bit future-looking, but we are seeing signs of success. So that's my last slide for 2024 outlook. 5G and LoRaWAN very often have been presented as competing. How many times did I hear, you know, I'm not going to invest in LoRaWAN this year because 5G is going to provide ultra low power and really everything, so let's wait. And now I think the industry is maturing, the equipment is there, people really see what 5G does and it does not. And more customers realize that it's actually complementary. 5G does not do any form of low power. I think that's clear cut. It's not just not as low power as LoRaWAN, it's just no low power at all. But people are attracted to 5G, private 4G and 5G for campuses because it is seen as the sort of Wi-Fi of operational technology networks, you know, reliable Wi-Fi in a way. And more, we get this request to deploy both LoRaWAN and private 4G and 5G. As you know, we are also active in private 4G and 5G with ThingPark providing private calls. And one of the use cases that's particularly interesting is LoRaWAN gateways using CBRS private cellular backhaul. It's a great use case for POCs. You know, private 5G, private 4G is really at POC stage, you know, same level of maturity as what LoRaWAN was maybe 4 years ago. And in those POCs, people are always trying to find use cases. Now, what can I do that's useful for my POC? Well, you take all the LoRaWAN use cases and you connect the gateways on CBRS backhaul. Maybe you add a few cameras on 4G or 5G. And we get very good feedback from this way of addressing a combination of 5G and 4G in campuses. So that's it for sort of outlook of beginning of 2024. Many interesting things, and I let the floor to the other speakers. Thank you all.
Next is an interview with Nicolas Sornin, co-inventor of the LoRa technology. Nicolas and I talked about the past, current, and future of LoRaWAN, and also about his new ventures. Hi, Nicolas. It's great to see you again after our meeting in Amsterdam.
Hi, Alper.
So for those of us who doesn't know Nicolas already, Nicolas Sornin is the co-inventor of the LoRa technology, the very technology that we've been building a very large ecosystem and taking a crack at building massive IoT. He is the chief scientific officer of EPIC, and also my colleague from the days that we have chaired the technical committee together in the LoRa Alliance.
Yeah, we did quite a good job together.
Absolutely. So what I'd like to do is to start with zooming in on the action on the ground, EPIC. Can you tell us more about what you guys do at EPIC?
Yeah, of course. At EPIC, we're in the business of developing and producing what we call a safety beacon, basically a tracker with a recovery technology embedded in it. So I'll describe what this is. So it's essentially a GPS tracker that communicates via LoRaWAN and Sigfox. Currently, on the LoRaWAN side, we are using both terrestrial networks, so sub-gigahertz ISM band trackers, and we are using the new S-band LoRaWAN satellite capability that was just brought in by the Alliance like a year ago. Okay, so we use both satellite and terrestrial network as our backhauling technology. And on top of that, we have device-to-device search capability based on radio ranging that enables recovery of a device even in totally GPS-deprived environment, whether it's interference or you're indoor or you're in a snowstorm or you're underwater or anywhere GPS wouldn't work. If you can still establish just a LoRa link, we managed to find you.
Okay, sounds like you guys have the mix of all the advanced features, including combining terrestrial and satellite networks, multi-radio, and as I understand, you guys also do roaming, where you stitch together various LoRaWAN networks, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So basically, on the LoRaWAN front, I forgot to say something. Yes, our device is really massively multi-protocol because it supports both LoRaWAN and Sigfox, on the terrestrial side and satellite LoRaWAN. And on the LoRaWAN, we effectively among the first company to leverage roaming. We currently have a roaming agreement with TTN. So we're leveraging the TTN infrastructure via the roaming hub infrastructure. So basically, we own our own network of gateways that we deploy in principally in the Alps, but we start deploying in the Pyrenees and in the Swiss Alps, Italian Alps also. And apart from that, we also leverage the gateways that have been deployed by TTN.
Right, and I also know that another network also leverages the gateways that you guys built in the field, like the birds roaming with your network.
Exactly, and so reciprocally, we also share the capacity that we've built in the places where we've deployed our gateway to provide provide coverage for the water meters of birds. Mm-hmm. So when birds is actually submitting an offer to a tender in an area where we already have coverage, so principally in mountainous places. If we have coverage, they just use our gateway, and that avoid them deploying, you know, costly infrastructure while it's not required.
Great. So as we see in the market, there's a lot of momentum behind tracking, and within the tracking, you are going after a particular vertical within that. And search and rescue, and also various types of activities. So where typically do people use Epic products these days?
I know the version one of the product did not embed satellite connectivity. So a real usefulness was limited where we could actually deploy either our own coverage or there was existing LoRaWAN or Sigfox coverage. But basically, to be able to guarantee coverage, because we're doing a life-saving product, we only sold that product in B2B application where we could actually deploy the coverage ourselves by bringing the gateway, so the radio network coverage, principally ski resort, a few oil platform, some windmill maintenance use case, thing like this, where actually the network coverage came as part of the package. What satellite is going to enable us to do is to guarantee coverage pretty much everywhere and therefore be able to target B2C markets now.
Okay, great. And so aside from the particular tracking opportunity, I'm wondering where you see other opportunities for LoRaWAN to grow. So, well, obviously we see opportunities everywhere, but among all these various verticals and use cases, are there any particular ones where you see faster return on investment, quicker deployment cycles?
So I can only talk about what I know and I'm involved in at the moment. But for example, just as part of Epic, we have received several requests to apply our know-how and technology to the logistic use case. Mm-hmm. So basically, people see that we can actually recover people in shitty situation, and they feel, I lose so many pallets a year. Could I use the same technology to recover my pallets? Mm-hmm. And actually, the answer is yes. LoRaWAN is actually at the wonderful advantage that it's easy and cheap to deploy and can be done by non-technical people. Mm-hmm. That you can basically own the network infrastructure. So in the case, for example, of logistic, it is crucially important that you own your radio infrastructure in your warehouses from a cost-based perspective. You cannot necessarily afford a SIM card subscription per pallet. It wouldn't make any sense. Mm-hmm. So basically, this concept that you can provide your own coverage via a private network deployment for your assets is, I think, absolutely essential in the logistic use case. And then add on top of that the recovery capability, and you start to have a sexy product for those guys.
Mm-hmm. So then zooming out a little bit, so going back to the days when you started working on building the LoRa, the modulation technology. So what did you have in mind back then in terms of vision where this technology will take us? And then looking at where we are, does it really match what you had in mind? Are we ahead? Are we behind? Where do you think that delta is coming from? What's your
thinking about that? I think there's a huge gap between what I thought would happen and what actually happened. It's vastly more successful than I thought it would be in terms of number of devices deployed, but they are not deployed at all in the application I was envisioning. So really, when I started to work on LoRa, I was thinking about, for example, outside network phone to phone texting. I was really, because I was a phone guy, I was coming from that phone industry. I was, my previous job was designing Wi-Fi and Bluetooth chip for phones. And my main customer was Nokia. So of course I was in this mindset, right? I had never thought that our first customer would be a water metering company, for example, which was actually, Veolia was amongst the first mass produced or mass, the biggest volume customer. And now I see, the latest tender from the Italian, from this Italian metering company announcing 5 million meters, all equipped with LoRaWAN. So that's amazing. It's brilliant to see that now LoRaWAN technology is actually included in nearly all the tenders in smart metering. So this smart metering use case, which seemed to be one of the main drivers for the LoRaWAN technology today, I hadn't thought about it at all.
Right. And right now, do you think how far are we from realizing the full potential of LoRaWAN? So now let's look at now and the future. Are we where we should be, or what's your prediction? What's your vision about the future? Where else will this technology go? How far will it go?
So I think if you look at it from as a connectivity technology, it already delivers what it should. So it's robust. The standard now has reached a level of maturity that many customers are able to implement it. It's definitely one of the cheapest wireless technology to implement out there. Anything else is probably more anything else is more expensive. However, it lacks wide coverage, and it lacks wide coverage not because there aren't enough gateways out there, but because all those gateways are only covering just a little, because today we have a juxtaposition of private network not talking to each other. And I think that's really the main burden. It's one reason why people are still hesitating between LTE-M or NB-IoT and LoRaWAN when they have to do, for example, a tracker. Say, oh, but I don't have wide area tracking, wide area coverage with LoRaWAN. That's a reason why Sigfox still exists today, basically. Mm-hmm. It's because they provide this wide area coverage that LoRaWAN hasn't delivered.
Right.
And the reason, and there are two factors for that. One is clearly getting roaming really in the field, making it a reality. Today, it's still more a concept than a reality. It works technically with the best proof. API-K is the best proof of that. Mm-hmm. It's actually not that hard to get it going. It's actually very simple to get it work. But basically, the business behinding the business model is still not very clear or not very widespread, not very readable for most of the users. And then I think satellites is also coming in. It brings a new interesting angle to that problem of ubiquitous coverage. So if we can make devices that are multimode leverage satellite as a roaming channel to their home base, that starts to become very, very interesting and very unique as from a technology standpoint and capability standpoint.
Right. In terms of the coverage, you're right. The Sigfox had a really good head start, and with a lot of investment, they have covered numerous countries. And when public networks had a pretty good momentum, then it kind of slowed down. Then that gave the way to the enterprise networks all around. Nevertheless, we still see new public networks joining the party, like Dre in Austria and PacketWorks in Philippines, coming to the nationwide coverage. And I think I would say one advantage of LoRaWAN is on the technical side, the ability to easily stitch together networks among public, private, community, on the ground, in space. And for that, as ThingPark Exchange, the roaming hub that API-K is also using, thing is providing that technical interconnection. But I do agree with your point that when it comes to the commercials, like how to price connectivity, how to price roaming, that's where we still need some more evolution to match the needs of the market with what is being offered. I think it's accelerating from both ends. The demand is accelerating, so is the evolution to match. And we have a really good momentum, but there's definitely more work to be done.
And I would, you know, if LoRaWAN wants to seriously compete with guys like Sigfox or LTM, I think it's a responsibility of the ecosystem to come up with some kind of offers and say, you know, oh, you want Europe-wide coverage, then this group of operators has teamed up together to actually bring you a very simple offer that provides you, you know, you want 100 messages per day, Europe-wide for your devices, here it comes. That's the cost. But for the moment, that doesn't exist. You have to go and ring and call all those guys and connect them to. So it's a little bit, you build a custom offer every time you want something. And we can do it. We can afford to do it because we know the guys. We know who to call. But for somebody starting from the ground up, it doesn't even know who to call. Who should be talking to, right?
Yeah. So, and then they get some numbers and they have to do the math. The burden is on the customer who wants to roam all around across Europe to figure this out. So there are no ready-made solutions out there. I think we're like one or maybe two steps away from that. I would say we're working towards that, but we're not there yet. And that's definitely some burden. And companies like Epic is able to solve that, but not everyone has the kind of access.
And again, technically, so setting up roaming, technically, once the business was sorted out, was like a matter of day. Extremely quick,
right?
So it's not a technical problem. It's really getting the solving the pricing issue, solving the money problem.
True. Looking at the future of LoRaWAN, so what do you think are the biggest threats or the largest friction points? It might be based on the competing technologies emerging or some other elements. What is it that we as the LoRaWAN ecosystem be worried about or spending our cycles on, in your opinion, to make this go even faster?
Honestly, from the enterprise market, so basically private network, you know, asset monitoring, things like this, I don't see what could replace the LoRa, you know, I don't see a better technology with a cheaper entry point to do that, okay? Where really where I think LoRaWAN is struggling or is gonna struggle in the next couple of years is really, you know, the low power wide area devices. So devices that just actually go outside, you know, building or outside the warehouse, and you want some global coverage for it, or an aggregation of coverage or bubbles of, you know, coverage in important places for it. Providing guaranteed coverage in the area of interest for a customer at an interesting price. This is where actually where the classic cellular operator are going to try to compete. In the enterprise market, I think it's now pretty well entrenched. Okay. And we typically you see the latest offer on even on smart metering, which is typically a wide area deployment. What I see, nearly all tenders now are actually mandating LoRaWAN. So it doesn't necessarily mean it's the only technology. Some, you know, mandate dual mode, or but at least you need to have this capability for LoRaWAN communication in your device if you want to have a chance to win. So for me, it's a very serious sign that the technology is now, you know, in mass volume and is there to last.
Okay. And my last question is about, you know, you being a prolific innovator, it is unthinkable to think that you would only be working on one thing. So an upside down Zeppelin behind you. So is there some other cool project you're working on these days you want to talk about?
Yeah, I'm working, we're building, I'm also part of another company called iHond that I created 18 months ago. We are building an airship. What you see behind me is not a Zeppelin, actually. It's an American airship. It's the Shenandoah, one of the biggest American airships, in between the two wars, in the 1930 era. And that's a very famous picture where it actually hangs vertical by its nose to its mooring tower or its mooring mast, because it was actually caught in kind of a storm. It's very impressive. And yeah, the whole thing is like 200 meters high. So it's like a 2FL, just standing like this, floating. So ours is much, much, much smaller. It's a two people or airship, but it's the first aircraft that's fly by radio. And guess what? We're using LoRa.
All right, great.
So entirely piloted by radios is no worries. It's an electrically propelled airship. And the link between the pilot and the engines is purely by radio using LoRa.
Okay, and I remember it's not LoRaWAN because...
I know, it's there is some LoRaWAN in there now. So the controls are not LoRaWAN because I need a very low latency link and bidirectional link. So it's actually a custom protocol that we engineered. However, there are some sensors in the envelope which are not latency critical. So we're monitoring pressure, we're monitoring tensile strength in the fabric, we're monitoring temperature of the gas inside the cell, et cetera, et cetera. And those are leveraging LoRaWAN actually. Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay, Nicolas, thank you. As always, it's a very insightful conversation. Yeah, whoever should definitely catch you for a glimpse of this type of conversations, I would highly recommend. So I'd like to thank you, and I hope to do this again in a future episode of our events.
And next time, be sure we can announce one or two more partners for this roaming agreement.
Absolutely, we're always working on that. As you know, we'll let you know. The moment a deployment needs more than a few gateways, the first question that pops up in people's mind is what type of gateways to use and where to place them. So-called radio network planning. Our resident RF expert and ThingPark Wireless and Enterprise product manager, Ramez Soss, will demystify the RF planning concept and also introduce network planning tools. Ramez brings his cellular telco RF expertise to LoRaWAN that we have been enjoying both at the LoRa Alliance through his contributions to the standard and also with the ThingPark product development.
Hi, everyone. I am Ramez Soss, a ThingPark's product manager and RF specialist at Actility. And I'm glad to present you the main guidelines of LoRaWAN RF planning and how ThingPark network tools can help you easily do this RF planning, starting from the design phase till the validation phase in the field. Here, I will focus on the RF planning methodology for outdoor macro LoRaWAN gateways installed on high points, such as rooftops or mounted on towers. But for indoor design, the methodology remains very similar to outdoor gateways, but the planning tools are different. Before digging into the details, let's first set the expectations of such RF planning exercise. In other words, why should LoRaWAN network deployment engineers care about RF planning? The first objective is to estimate the RF coverage range offered by a LoRaWAN gateway. Such coverage depends on your design criteria. For instance, the gateway shall offer a larger coverage to outdoor devices over SF12 compared to indoor devices using SF9. And then, after assessing the coverage of a single gateway, you would need to estimate how many gateways are required to cover the area of interest. And this is typically required at pre-sales stage to establish a bill of quantity and compute your total cost of ownership. And then you would need to choose the optimal placement for your gateways, relying on RF simulation tools to predict the coverage provided by your future gateways before proceeding to the rollout phase. Then, after installing your gateways, you would need to assess the effective RF coverage provided by your gateway fleet, this time relying on field measurements rather than prediction studies. And doing RF planning also helps you determine the potential coverage gaps in your existing network, correlating them with quality of service problems reported by operational teams. This assessment allows you to decide whether gateway densification is required and where to put your new gateways. Last but not the least, besides coverage assessment, doing RF planning allows you to estimate the radio capacity offered by your gateways by assessing the expected density of your devices according to the mix of traffic profiles you want to serve in your network. Now that we have set the scope, the next question would be, how to do a serious RF planning? One would say, LoRa RF planning is quite simple. I can easily derive the expected path loss by subtracting the receiver sensitivity from the radiated power of the transmitter. Then I can convert this path loss into cell range by using a propagation model that is appropriate for the sub gigahertz propagation. Is the exercise really that simple? From my 18 years of experience in RF planning, I can definitely answer nope. And I will explain you why in the coming slides. A crucial step in any serious RF planning is to compute the link budget in both uplink and downlink directions. And in each direction, the link budget shall compute the maximum allowable path loss, taking into account the transmit power, the receiver sensitivity, the different gains and losses, as well as the additional design margins. Then the link having the smaller MAPL becomes the limiting link, and its MAPL dictates the maximum allowed distance between the transmitter and the receiver through the adequate propagation model. And the gains consist mainly of the transmission and receiver antenna gains, plus the coverage overlapping gain offered by macro diversity. The losses are essentially caused by the gateway's cable and connector losses. And then the design margins consist of additional losses deducted from the total path loss in order to model some specific RF phenomena, such as the fading effect and in-building penetration. In other words, directly converting the total path loss into distance is not correct. Only part of the total path loss can be used to estimate the maximum cell range, and this part is the MAPL. Let's now take a glance at the different design margins required to derive a realistic MAPL. The first one is the small-scale shadowing margin, which is caused by the fast fading effects. So the receiver sensitivity provided by the chip manufacturer is valid for AWGN static channel conditions. However, in reality, the channel conditions are never static, making the RF signal experience large and abrupt fluctuations over time, even when both the transmitter and the receiver are not moving. The different copies of the signal arriving at the receiver from different multipasses sometimes combine constructively and other times destructively, as you can see from the blue curve here. You may try to measure it by yourself. If you observe the received signal strength over 20 or 30 uplink packets at a stationary location from a single gateway, you will roughly see fluctuation of plus or minus 10 dB around the average signal strength. This fast fading effect follows a relay distribution for non-line of sight propagation, and therefore a margin should be accounted on top of the AWGN sensitivity values to account for small-scale relay fading. This margin depends on the target packet error rate and the number of repetitions of each packet. The good news is that the overlapping between several gateways allows mitigating part of this fast fading effect for uplink paths. Take the example of the macro diversity of 2, where uplink packets are received by 2 gateways. So a fading hole for gateway A would be typically compensated by gateway B and vice versa. Similar positive effect happens with uplink repetitions, offering both time and frequency diversity to mitigate the fast fading effects. Another propagation phenomenon is about the shadowing effect. So empirical propagation models predict an average path loss versus distance, and typically these models are calibrated in a way to have the average error versus field measurement as close as possible to zero. And then each propagation model is associated with a standard deviation representing the path loss variation with respect to the average predicted value. This variation is caused by shadowing effects due to obstacles, buildings, trees, and so on. And typical standard deviation of most propagation models is around 8 dB. Therefore, unless an additional margin is considered in the RF planning, the predicted path loss derived by the propagation model at a given distance shall be valid with only 50% probability, since it's an average prediction. And to guarantee a higher coverage probability, like 95%, you must add a large-scale shadowing margin. Let's now tackle the in-building penetration losses, which are typically considered by additional margins on top of outdoor path loss. So different penetration levels require different margins. For example, for indoor daylight, or what we also typically call light indoor or indoor first wall, we typically add 11 to 18 dB on top of the outdoor path loss, depending on the morphology. And for deep indoor, you can typically consider 5 dB on top of the indoor daylight losses, but the exact values typically depend on the wall material. And for basement, like for metering applications, consider 10 dB extra losses on top of the deep indoor penetration. But here again, the exact values depend on the building material, the floor-to-floor isolation, and the number of underground levels to cover. The fourth design margin I would like to tackle is the interference margin. So as said previously, the receiver sensitivities consider AWGN channel conditions. Hence, they only include the effect of thermal noise, which is typically around negative 120 dBm for LoRaWAN gateways. However, in reality, the overall noise floor is potentially increased above the thermal noise due to the interference effect. Such interference could be either induced by other LoRa signal or signals from other radio technologies using the same unlicensed spectrum. Therefore, the RF analysis should take this effect into consideration by an additional interference margin, or we also call it noise rise above thermal noise. So this margin is typically assessed by noise scan analysis. And note that the uplink and downlink noise rise is usually not symmetrical since the gateways and the end devices are not located at the same elevation. Also, the uplink noise rise depends on the proximity of your gateways from neighboring cellular antennas like LTE, for example. In this graph, you can see the noise scan results showing four spikes representing the interference caused by an RFID transmitter around the gateway in test in the 868 MHz ISM band. Let me now briefly present you our recommended RF planning methodology and how you can leverage the different ThingPark tools to execute the different steps of this methodology. The first step is about the link budget analysis, for which we have already elaborated some details in the previous slides. The main outcome of this step is to derive the approximate cell range according to your design criteria and estimate the approximate site count to establish a bill of quantity. To realize this step, you can rely on ThingPark's air interface dimensioning tool used by Actility's customers for more than 8 years already. And then the second step is about doing detailed RF coverage predictions with a radio planning tool. This step already reuses the MAPL analysis done in step one and simulates the RF coverage of each gateway, taking into account the gateway's exact location and the antenna height, as well as the radiation patterns of the gateway antenna and the effect of the terrain topography. The outcome of this step is a coverage heat map representing your design inputs and showing potential coverage holes. You can rely on ThingPark's network coverage tool to realize this step. And once your gateways are deployed, the third step consists of doing field tests to determine the real coverage of your network and compare them with prediction heat maps provided in step two. ThingPark provides you with a network survey tool to easily analyze your work test data and visualize the different RF metrics on a user-friendly interface. Let me now quickly zoom in on each of these tools. Starting from the ThingPark Air Interface Dimensioning tool, which is an Excel-based tool developed by Actility to analyze the LoRaWAN link budgets and estimate the radio capacity of each gateway. As you can see from this diagram, the tool takes into account several pieces of inputs like the transmission power and the receiver sensitivity, the morphology-specific parameters, the regulatory limits of each country, like the maximum allowed transmission power or the maximum spending factor or the duty cycle limitations. And it also takes into account all the design parameters, like what's your target packet error rate for both uplink and downlink, what's your maximum spending factor, what's the maximum number of repetitions for uplink packets, and so on. And it also accounts for all the margins and gains that we have already elaborated in previous slides. In output, the tool provides the analysis about the maximum allowable pass loss, and it derives an estimation of the cell range and the intersite distance together with the appropriate area covered by each base station. Let me quickly show you how this tool looks like. So here is the ThingPark Air Interface Dimensioning tool. It's an Excel-based tool. You can see here one sheet to set all your main inputs, which are all marked in blue. And you can see among the inputs, you can set the regulatory rules together with the frequency band for your deployment. And you can set for each morphology, starting from dense urban, urban, suburban, down to rural, you can set some design parameters like what is your target uplink spending factor at cell H, what is the target maximum packet error rate, the number of transmissions for each uplink packets, and the same thing for downlinks. And you can also set your end device location between outdoor, indoor daylight, deep indoor, or basement. And there are, you have some other metrics and some inputs that you can set here. And among your other inputs, you can also set all the end device characteristics in terms of transmission power and antenna gain, and the same thing on the gateway side. And then in the other sheet, you have the output sentences, where for each morphology, we have potentially three different link budgets, depending on the receiver slots that you intend to use for downlink for your design. So let's assume that you do that for the downlink RX2. So you have an uplink link budget and the downlink link budget based on RX2. And then the tool estimates the link budget in each direction and tells you what is the limiting link and provides you with the analysis about the maximum allowable pass loss, the cell range, the inter-site distance, the site coverage area, and finally, the number of sites required to cover a target area depending on the area to be covered for each morphology. And if you want to go into the details about the detailed link budget for each morphology, so you can find them in separate sheets. And another quite interesting thing in the tool is that you have the assessment of the cell capacity. So you also have all the information regarding the uplink and downlink cell capacity analysis, depending on your input metrics, like your uplink payload size, your downlink payload size, the average number of uplink and downlink packets per day per device, the number of logical channels supported by your deployment, and accordingly, the output of the tool would be the total uplink cell capacity and the maximum device density, assuming a uniform distribution of your end devices. Let me now zoom in on ThingPark's network coverage tool, which is Actility's RF coverage prediction tool used in radio network planning for outdoor macro gateways. It's not suitable for coverage prediction of indoor gateways. This tool already embeds the link budget analysis, so it addresses both steps 1 and 2 of the methodology presented earlier. The tool also supports a large set of antenna patterns from the most deployed antenna manufacturers in the LoRaWAN ecosystem. Additionally, the tool embeds a digital elevation model database covering the whole Earth with 30 meter resolution. And this DTM allows the tool to compute the diffraction loss caused by hilly obstacles to model the terrain shadowing effect. And finally, the tool supports two propagation models, one modeling a conservative or a safe prediction scenario, and another one modeling an optimistic prediction scenario. Let me now quickly show you how the tool looks like. So here is the ThingPark network coverage tool, which is seamlessly integrated with your ThingPark wireless or your ThingPark enterprise account. So you can see here, I have already prepared two simulations, one for outdoor simulation, and I have set a given set of device settings and regulatory settings and link budget settings, like for example, two transmissions. And here it's for outdoor simulation. I can show you with the location of devices assumed to be outdoor. You can see this is the expectation of the tool regarding the coverage. And if I do the same thing from exactly the same parameters, but just replacing outdoor simulation with indoor daylight device location, so you can see that the tool predicts a different coverage. Of course, the coverage is shrinked with respect to what we have, what we had with the outdoor simulation. And that's why the tool can be used to help you analyze several deployment scenarios. And you can play with the design assumptions and with the device location in order to predict the coverage of each specific case. And if you want to set a new simulation, to add a new simulation, so you go here and you follow the different steps, starting by setting the prediction type of your simulation, whether it's safe or optimistic prediction, which will dictate the appropriate propagation model for each scenario. And then you can set your simulation settings from the device and the regulatory settings. And then you can set, if necessary, you can change the default settings of your link budget settings by setting your uplink and downlink noise rise or the maximum spending factor or the number of repetitions. And then you can prepare the list of your base stations. Either you can do a greenfield assessment for new gateways not yet included into your ThingPark account, or you can reuse gateways from your ThingPark account by exporting the list of existing base stations already retrieved under your ThingPark account. And once you are ready, you just import your CSV file, and then you are done. And if you want to do pure link budget analysis, So you can rely on the Swagger interface so that you can access this link budget API and do your link budget assessment in a way that is very similar to the AIR interface dimensioning tool that was just described before. Now, let me talk to you quickly about the network survey tool. So the ThingPark network survey tool is a field test analysis tool helping to assess the RF coverage with real devices and gateways. It offers a rich set of RF metrics, such as the packet loss analysis, representing coverage holes on the map by gray dots, the uplink and downlink SNR, RSSI, and estimated signal power, and an estimation also of the uplink and downlink interference levels along the walk test, and also an assessment of the network geolocation precision by comparing the coordinates generated by the ThingPark location solver with the real GPS coordinates reported by the device in its payload. And finally, the ThingPark spectrum analysis is another member of the family of network tools. This tool helps you easily estimate the noise level of your frequency band and choose the best frequencies for your deployment by avoiding noisy channels. The spectrum analysis tool is seamlessly integrated with your ThingPark gateway management portal. Therefore, you can easily launch your noise scan campaign from your gateway management portal and then view the results in the spectrum analysis tool. Not only you can analyze the scan results of individual gateways, but the tool also allows you to do time and spatial aggregation of individual scan results over a given group of gateways. Such aggregation is indeed very useful to provide you statistically relevant insight about the interference level of a given geographical zone, since the RF channel planning is generally consistent across a full zone, not personalized specifically and separately for each gateway. And now, if you want to leverage these ThingPark network tools integrated with the ThingPark Enterprise product, sign up for free to our ThingPark community platform. You will then have access to the ThingPark Enterprise alongside the ThingPark network coverage, the network survey, and the spectrum analysis tools. Contact Actility if you want to buy credit on ThingPark network coverage or buy training services or even upgrade from the ThingPark community version to the fully supported ThingPark Enterprise SaaS or self-hosted. Thank you for your attention.
If you're not excited about connecting meters and machines, how about connecting wild animals for their welfare? Let's hear from Sophie Maxwell, Executive Director of Connected Conservation Foundation, how they leverage their cutting-edge IoT deployment to save animals and help planet. Be aware, the video includes a real chase scene involving poachers, helicopters, rangers, and dogs, all captured on an IoT dashboard.
Hello, everyone. My name is Sophie Maxwell. I'm Executive Director of the Connected Conservation Foundation, and our organization works to protect wildlife and natural ecosystems through technology. I'm excited to talk to you today about the role of LoRaWAN in conservation and how it's powering a new era in conservation management and protection. Thank you for the invite to speak at this recording. Actility, I really appreciate it. And I'm sorry that this isn't a live event, but if anybody has any questions or wants to talk to me, then please do get in touch with me on the LinkedIn details that are on this slide. But first, a little bit about connected conservation. We are a leading organization that's connecting the private technology sector with developing countries in Asia and Africa, really linking those who are on the front lines, protecting nature every day with the tools they need to save species and their habitats. We've been working since 2015, and we are a small organization, a small NGO, but we're making huge impact because we are supported by these fantastic partners on the bottom of the slide. So Actility, Cisco, Airbus Foundation, and Dimension Data, where we can unite these tech giants to really help enhance conservation now across 7 countries. Really, with these partners, we're providing the digital infrastructure, such as landscape-wide connectivity, communications, radios, satellite imagery, as well as sensors and the centerpiece, which is the IoT networks of sensors for conservation. So I'm going to talk to you today about a little use case. Well, it's not a little one, it's quite a big one. And also we have to first start with the challenge. And I'm sure most of you know that nature is really hurting. We've lost 1 million species are now predicted to go extinct in the next decade. And we've lost 70% of our wildlife in the last 40 years. Ecosystems are really struggling. And we really must now join everybody's capabilities and resources to tackle this challenge before it's too late. And there is recognition at the highest levels. In December 2022, the Global Biodiversity Framework was agreed. That brought together nearly 200 countries to sign targets to protect 30% of the planet by 2030. And technology really has a critical role to play in protecting this 30%. And it can really transform conservation efforts to strengthen the effectiveness of these protected areas. So from protection to getting early warnings of threats such as poaching, to monitoring these large areas, looking at ecosystem health indicators and where the species are moving, to verify the data and analyze it, to report on whether those conservation impacts are having an effect and inform the decision making for future strategies. Altogether, technology is really converging to strengthen the effectiveness of protected area management. And CCF's role is to enable the hardware and software for this purpose. So donating the equipment that's needed to collect the data in this remote locations, transfer it hundreds of kilometers over the networks to an operating center. And that includes live video from cameras, digital radios, sensor information from trackers and environmental capture as well. And LoRaWAN is really playing a central role. It's been used for about 8 years now in conservation, and the low cost nature of the sensors, the long range abilities and the low power applications really make it a very attractive technology to solve some of the problems we're facing. Now, we've been working with it for a long time with our partners Sabi Sands and NRT, learning about how the applications can really make a difference. You know, we go to site, we work with the challenges on the ground and set out the appropriate solutions to solve those problems. And all the data from the LoRaWAN sensors is transported over the network into a single system. That uses the Actility's ThingPark system, the connected conservation platform that transforms that data to display it in Earth Ranger. That's an analytics and visualization software that really kind of gives the rangers and the managers the eyes and ears across these huge landscapes and giving them centralized capabilities for decisions. And, you know, technology is the big multiplier. It's giving them an extraordinary leap forward in their capacity to respond to conservation issues. And here's a list of all the LoRaWAN networks that are used in conservation, specifically globally. These are the ones we're aware of. And you can see from here that they span all the continents. And I think these are the ones we're aware of. There are more, and there are more being deployed this year as well. Our organization has helped with 29 of these protected areas, protecting 5,600,000 hectares, and we have 6 new parks being deployed this year. And here you can see some of the pictures of the control rooms where we work with the partners who are analyzing this data for their conservation responses. The particular use case I wanted to talk to you about is where we have collaborated with Actility, Cisco, with EU funding to really help this fantastic organization called Northern Rangelands Trust, based in Kenya. Now, Northern Rangelands Trust, or NRT, is a member organization which brings together 43 community-led conservancies. And these conservancies also neighbor private reserves, such as Lewa and Oljogi and Borana. But this region is really challenged. You know, it's on the forefront of climate change, it's climate stressed, and it's huge. You know, we're talking 63,000 kilometers squared, and it's really a home to many different species and 100,000 households who also live in this area, right next to the wildlife, and have to coexist every day with a huge array of threatened species. And recent years, the area saw some really severe drought, and this could give a massive challenge on lack of food, lack of water for all of the inhabitants. And NRT really needed to use technology to tackle this threat and manage the resources for the benefit of everyone. So looking at water levels, forage, the movement of species across the landscape, the movement of livestock, so that it all can harmoniously exist together. So the network that we developed and we deployed is now 21 LoRa gateways. It started in Lewa and grew from there, and now it's across 26 conservancies, providing that surveillance and wildlife intelligence. And this has really helped all the conservancies come together, joining them so that they can tackle these issues together, share resources, share strategies. And this has been really successful. To tackle things like poaching, you know, Kenya has seen zero poaching in 2020 and 2022. And between 2017 and 2021, the black rhino population actually grew by 6%. So it's a fantastic success. But people have made this happen, and we are really, really proud to enable those people with the right tools to have that surveillance capability, to look at the wildlife intelligence. And KWS, the government agency there, has stated that surveillance and wildlife intelligence is a good contributing factor to these successes. So we are proud to play a very small part in this national achievement. So here is an example of all the sensors coming through the Actility system. We have nearly 300 sensors now deployed, and we've been blown away by the number of use cases that have been delivered. And here you can see some of the trackers from smart parks, and there is really an explosion now of wildlife tracking sensors with many different providers coming onto the market. And here you can see a list of all the different use cases. We're serving 20 plus use cases, and that includes ranger tracking, so promoting the safe and effective patrols and tracking of rangers, vehicle tracking to look at the movement of tourist vehicles as well as ranger vehicles to be able to look for suspicious behavior. And so for security alarms on fences to tell when they're damaged or there might be a poaching incursion. So I mentioned wildlife tracking. You know, there's a lot of trackers now deployed on rhinos, and this has enabled us to enable the teams on the ground to increase these rangelands so that they know where their rhinos are and they know they're safe. And predator tracking and elephant tracking. I mean, if you're living alongside wildlife, you want an early warning if that pride of lions is coming near your community. And so being able to geofence areas to give that alarm call of an elephant coming in to raid crops or a pride of lions nearby has been hugely valuable. And another area that's really taking off is livestock tracking. So if you're managing grasslands for wildlife and community livestock, understanding grazing patterns, where those livestock are moving can really help. So if you look at the bottom left, you can see an image of all the data coming in to the operations room. Now, each of these screens is actually showing a separate conservancy, and the image at the top is showing the operations room where everything is coming in together and they're able to make decisions and respond. And the best thing is really the roaming. So, you know, elephants, rhinos, they don't say, oh, I'm going outside a private LoRa network, I better turn around and go back. No, they will go between the networks. So being able to see as they move through different conservancies has been hugely valuable. And those conservancies can choose through our system to share the data with everyone or keep it private to their own. So an additional success is here, and I think we're very grateful to 51 Degrees, our tech implementation partner in Kenya with this project, who has supplied this video to us. So it's in a recording of Lewa, and it is an incident where a report of potential poachers coming into Lewa Conservancy was relayed back to the ops room. And each of the anti-poaching units has trackers, and they were able then to fly in more anti-poaching units with a helicopter to give them support. A dog unit was deployed, and that dog unit was actually tracked. And through the LoRa trackers on the dogs, you could actually see the direction of travel. And then that was relayed to the other anti-poaching unit in the east there, and they were able then to apprehend, move to where they predicted the poachers would go based on the trajectory of the dogs, and then make that apprehension. So you can really see how this real-time information is providing the intelligence to keep species safe and be able to stop these poaching incidents. So then moving on, what does the future look like? Well, it's very bright for LoRaWAN in conservation. I think we have seen the proven success with the sites that we've supported for the ability of these technologies to be able to improve the effective management of these protected areas. We're dreaming big. You know, we want to scale up these solutions. There are many, many more protected areas in the world, and we envision a connected network of well-equipped, well-managed protected areas where the tech is enabling capabilities for thriving wildlife, thriving ecosystems, and community livelihoods. So working together with more partners, we can work to bring species back from the brink and save this 1 million from going extinct. So with LoRaWAN playing a central role in some of these networks, I think it's evolving so fast. We want to help it and help it keep pace with needs. So some of the key developments that we're excited about coming down the pipe are roaming. So talking to Actility, we've got new solutions for being able to track species as they move through different private networks. And that will increase collaboration of everybody working together. Repeat use. So with the NRT project, you know, what's been great in creating the uptake of that project is that once one sensor is uploaded, other conservancies can then use it within a kind of library approach. And we're kind of keeping a sensor technology registrar. So every sensor that we test, we are then able to advise other conservancies on the best ones for their challenge. And there's a huge innovation, as I mentioned, happening in animal tracking. And another area that we are excited about is LoRaWAN gateways on satellites. So obviously it's very expensive to put terrestrial masts up across undulating landscapes and deploy those networks. So we believe that, you know, from space, it will unlock new opportunities as well. So we don't see this slowing down. And if anything, we want to make it easy for the end user and help those conservationists save species with this technology help. So we actually have six new projects this year. We've fantastic donations from Cisco for support of these parks in Uganda, Botswana, Kenya, and we really need support from others. You know, people make this happen. So if you do want to head over to our website and donate to complement this technology with support for those on the ground, that would be fantastic. If you know of any tech partners, sensor manufacturers, we are always open to new solutions. So please do get in touch, and we thank you very much and really hope to hear from you. All the best.
We hope you have enjoyed watching our very first episode. If you are as excited about the LoRaWAN technology as we are and you would like to get your hands on it, check out the ThingPark marketplace to find devices, solutions, and gateways, and try them on ThingPark community network platform free of charge. And for anything else, contact us at active.com. Thank you for watching, and let's meet at the next episode.